Hello, I'm Rob Hirschfeld, CEO and co-founder of RackEnt, and you are in for an adventure about bare metal infrastructure, what I like to call OVNO, our adventures in bare metal infrastructure. And I'm going to tell this story in three acts. And it really is designed to be a fable where we work through a crisis. I'm introducing my GIF as Ollie the operator. And Ollie's got a real challenge, probably the same challenge that you are facing on a daily basis. There's a lot of cloud costs that people are asking about. Your VMware costs are going way up, and people are questioning if virtualization as a consequence is even the right thing. And AI questions are mounting too. And we're going to dig into all of these things. First, it's important to note that the Broadcom change is part of a broader trend line where we are starting to realize that virtualization is no longer the king of your data center. Yes, there is a Broadcom component that's making this happen, but infrastructure architects, and hopefully you're among the people helping make this decision, if not questioning in your organization, asking, do we really need virtualization in the same way? And if we don't need virtualization, how does that impact our hardware designs? How do we look at our data center? That's exactly the crisis we're in and what we're going to be talking about. Virtualization dominance will quickly decline. And we're seeing this across the board as customers question the use of VMware, but they're also looking at the need for containerized delivery, GPU-hungry workloads. A lot of the virtualization benefit that we saw does not apply in these instances. There's very little virtualization benefit for oversubscription, keep everything up, vMotion, that type of SAN isolation work. And it adds a lot of cost and complexity to your deployments if you could just move into bare metal. So what we need to be doing is questioning this 100% migration cloud economic methodology. We know, and we hear this very clearly, cloud repatriation is a thing. That doesn't mean moving back to 1990s era data centers. It doesn't mean abandoning the cloud. What it means is looking at your consumption versus owned asset pricing, that rent versus buy curve, and understanding that for not all workloads benefit from cloud economics, that when you have stable workloads and certain needs, you can make a better investment. Workloads are long-term predictive, are a great candidate. And we're starting to realize, and more companies see this, cloud native is not cloud exclusive. You can do API-driven, dynamic scale-out designs, workloads, and deployments on your own self-managed infrastructure. And we're also hearing that data governance is a real concern. Improving control, keeping data within your own control zones are all important, but a lot of companies have lost the skills required to run their own infrastructure. In some cases, they wanted to get out of the thinking that it held them back before, but now we need to reacquire these skills so you can bring them back online. And that's exactly the type of challenge that we're talking about in this first act, that crisis of, can I run infrastructure? How do I run infrastructure? How do I rebuild the skills? And this is combined with the challenge of a generational hardware refresh. We're really in the midst of a transition from a type of infrastructure class driven by virtualization, where we looked at virtualization hosts. And now we're starting to think about AI workers. Very different economics, very different spending patterns. And it enables us to look at the hardware differently, actually architect a different type of hardware. Less CPU per socket pricing driven by VMware licensing and more about GPUs and network bandwidth. It means that we can look at different physical form factors, things that don't have as expensive of a server, that maybe don't have to have all of the RAM or the interconnect, expensive interconnect to a SAN. We also need to be very wary of how power works in our data centers now. And we also can break free of some of our vendor CPU restrictions. The idea that we couldn't intermix CPU types inside of a virtualization cluster or a virtualization architecture no longer apply. And we can start looking at new CPU vendors. So now that we understand just how challenging this environment is, we can start looking at how we're going to get ready to take advantage of all of this change, because ultimately, as a leader, that's your job. So let's look at what you need to know to really start taking advantage of the change and turmoil to build a better infrastructure. First is really understanding how provisioning works. And I want to take you through a couple of scenarios that we see all the time, give you a little bit of information about benefits and pros and cons. Fundamentally, robust API-driven controls with multi-vendor abstractions are transformative. And you need to think about this not just as a provisioning problem, but a day one and day two problem. Because provisioning well, we see this all the time with our customers, doesn't mean just a do-it-once thing. The more often, the more effectively you can provision, the more advanced and cloud-like your infrastructure will become. And that's essential for some of the techniques and processes that we're going to get to in Act 3. The first and simplest path for provisioning is when you're actually replacing an operating system. In that case, you have a very straightforward path that is followed by most every provisioning operation that we see. You go through a DHCP next server and you pixie that server to install the operating system. That's known as network booting or netboot. And it is a place where you can go in and run a process built into the BIOS of your server that does this process. We're going to talk about that a little bit more. There's an alternate process that we see in places where you don't have as good control of the network. You can't build a provisioning network, or you have security restrictions in which you attach a bootable media to the server itself out of band. And that allows you to then boot a system up without having to go through a pixie process. This process does work for those more restrictive scenarios, but it is requires a much higher degree of operational control and readiness for organizations. And so even ones that have very sophisticated tools often find that the overhead of managing this type of process and sustaining it can be a bit daunting compared to something that is as straightforward and battle-proven as a pixie boot network provision. Down the other side of this graph, we get into a discovery process. In this case, it's places where you already have existing infrastructure and you can't go through a reboot, reprovision process to get control of the machine. In a case like that, the most straightforward one is an IPMI scan. So this is actually using the out-of-band management, and we'll talk about this in a moment, to scan servers to discover them, understand what's going on without actually even logging into the systems. You're using the server's out-of-band control plane to do that work and create a degree of inventory. That can really work for a brownfield implementation where you don't want to disturb the existing workloads, but you have access to that out-of-band control. If you do have access to the servers, you can log in, you can install an agent, and you can perform an inventory there. In those cases, we see that as very interesting. But in a lot of cases, it can be difficult to find access and connect to the existing infrastructure that you have to perform that type of operation. Once you have these, then you can go through and get better control. But the first step in any physical infrastructure operations is actually knowing and having base control of all the machines in your data center and your infrastructure. From there, we start talking about out-of-band management or baseboard management controllers, BMCs. And I can't emphasize this enough. If you have servers, if you're managing servers, if you're planning to get some servers, secure your BMCs. You need to manage the passwords, certificates, access controls. These are things that should be automatically set up, maintained, ideally with unique passwords or at least something that's not the system passwords. These are a huge vulnerability point for your infrastructure and you should control them. It's something that Rackin will do out of the box because it's so critical and important. What these systems basically do is provide remote power and console access to a server, but they usually and should include patch management, boot, and advanced features like media attach that we mentioned just before. But because of these advanced features, it's very hard to abstract vendor BMCs. And you end up hearing something about a protocol called Redfish. It's really the dominant way that these systems are accessed now, but it's more of a protocol and not a simple abstraction. So you can't just say, oh, I'm using Redfish, so my Dell, HP, Cisco, Supermicro servers are now abstracted. You don't have to do that. The vendors still have differences in how they set up, run, maintain, that makes it where you are never going to be able to just ignore the fact that the servers have different vendors, their BIOS revs, their patch cycles, the data, the way you interact with servers is all different. Even though, highly recommend use these newer technologies. They are more secure. They are more stable and effective. And so you should definitely be using Redfish. Just don't expect it to create a blanket out-of-band management control plane just because you've bought servers that have Redfish in it. And it's important to recognize here that your out-of-band management is separate from your bare metal server. That separation is critical for you to be able to control and manage the system regardless of what's going on in the server, or even if there is no operating system installed yet. You get your operating system installed through a provisioning process, and then most of your access for that is through the network access systems or front door. One thing to note here is that we do a lot of actions, provisioning, and things like that through a discovery OS, so a diskless operating system that runs in boot, rather than through the out-of-band management. We have both control mechanisms, but being able to use vendor tools inside of the OS itself is actually a more scalable system. And that's what I want to highlight in this next slide. When we talk about maintaining the firmware on a server, it's important to realize that firmware is not just one thing on one of these bare metal servers. There are different types of servers, and they have what you do and how you set them up have significant implications on how that server is going to operate and how you have provisioning control. As a note, use UEFI BIOS. If you're still using legacy, get off it. It's not supported and maintained. You should be switching to UEFI. It does have some more operational demands, and this can actually create a bit of lift if you have a lot of servers, but very, very important to migrate into the new BIOS at this point. And then also remember that there are multiple firmware life cycles involved in the system. So GPUs, NICs, SSDs, other server components all have their own vendor tooling depending on where you got the SSDs from. So just because you have a Dell or an HP server doesn't mean that Dell and HP tools will update and patch your SSDs, your NIC, your RAID cards, your GPUs. Those are going to have vendor-specific tooling. In a lot of cases, that must be run from inside the operating system. That in-band OEM tooling that I was talking about before is necessary to update and patch. One of the stories that I like to tell here is that one of the SSD vendors had a software glitch that required to be patched. The glitch, if unpatched, would basically mark sectors as unusable even when they were usable. And that meant that the disks would degrade and fill up over time or reach zero through normal use at an artificially fast rate. To fix it, you had to break the RAID for the server. You had to patch the BIOS on each SSD in the system, which could be 10, 12, or higher numbers of SSDs in that infrastructure, and then rebuild the RAID and then reset the machine. That was a very intensive process. It required a lot of automation to do well, and it actually took a fair bit of time to walk through that process. That wasn't a hardware OEM tool. It's regardless of the hardware OEMs because they all use the same SSD vendors. You had to use the SSD vendor's tooling to do that patch. And so it's important when you're managing bare metal to understand that you have multiple control surfaces, multiple vendors, multiple composed parts of the server. And so you have to understand how you're going to do that boot and what you're going to do. And then prepare for a cycle so that you can do that work. We were able to completely automate the process for that the customer that first identified this SSD patch, and that saves hours and hours of manual effort per server. But it only works if you have control of the servers and you already have an automated sequence for them, which is why it's important to understand how you can get automated control of your systems, like we talked about in the last slide. Now, the final thing I want to point out here is that there is an option in UEFI BIOS to turn on secure boot. Turn this feature on. It operates to your benefit. It does have some more operational risk to it because your network boot chain needs to be trusted and signed, which is exactly why you want to turn it on, so that people can't inject untrusted BIOS or BIOS components, operating system components into your boot chains or into your running operating systems. It is absolutely critical to be able to do this. And even if you're using secure BIOS, you still need to be able to patch and update the BIOS itself, because the secure root of trust that goes into this is also updated and changed on a regular basis. So turn on secure boot, have a process to regularly update your firmware. It is absolutely essential for you to do this. And happily, not that hard. This might sound scary to you. These are things that are automated and standardized patterns. And that's really important. This is complex, but it's well understood work. There's not that many vendors. They have very good tooling, very good processes. Do not look at this and say, I have to figure out all this myself. Use the standard processes. They will accelerate your time. They will make you much better prepared. They will get help, follow standards, use the communities that you have available. And if you don't have a community, or find a community, if you're doing this all yourself, you are going to have a really sad, hard time because these are complex, challenging problems, even though they have well understood solutions. Speaking of solutions, in our third act, we can take this information, understanding that bare metal is accessible, that it can be used, that we can actually build on it, and start thinking about what we want it to be, how we want that infrastructure to go. And so let's break this down into some really important categories that you can use for planning your own bare metal adventures. The first thing here is understanding that architectures are shifting. We're no longer constrained by a VMware hardware stack. I think people have been on autopilot for the last 10, maybe even 15 years, just buying what the VMware vendors told us that we should do. But we're not constrained by that in this scaled out world, where we can actually build and pick what we're doing instead of having to pick a very tightly, narrowly constrained set of hardware from specific OEMs with specific integrations and specific patterns. But we don't have a clear reference architecture where you can go out and buy exactly one thing, know it's going to work exactly as is. That's going to save you a lot of money, but it's also going to mean that you have to do more legwork to understand what you're building. You have to build more operational controls and tooling around that. That's an opportunity for you to improve your vendor neutrality, to not have the vendor lock-in that exposed us to so much risk in the last decade. And it also gives us an opportunity to think about how we build reusable automation, actually have work that we can use and reuse across our infrastructure. Actually take some ownership for that operational control in your data center. The rewards are really, really high, both in cost savings, disaster preparedness, governance controls, right? The list goes on. This is a very, very effective way to run and manage your infrastructure. One of the biggest ways that we see people getting excited about this is the idea of running bare metal Kubernetes. As long as I've been involved in the Kubernetes communities, we have been chasing this holy grail. And in a lot of cases, we gave up on it and just ran Kubernetes on virtualized infrastructure. But fundamentally, virtualization is not required for Kubernetes. It adds a lot of cost. It adds operational complexity in the fact that you have to have a virtualization stack. But without that stack, you have to do the work that you are getting. So you're adding operational complexity to handle networking, DNS, operating system configuration, making sure that you understand how you're going to build the dynamic clusters. And the challenge here is that Kubernetes really has become a dynamic clusters model. It's very cloud friendly, meaning there's a lot of API and lifecycle requirements to run Kubernetes. You don't just build Kubernetes in your infrastructure and then throw away the key because you're done, like you did with VMware. Kubernetes is a multi-cluster design for the most part. And so all of the systems, once you build your management Kubernetes clusters, transforms into tooling that you need to then have a bare metal cloud that will build specific management application clusters on top of your management cluster. This is sort of a cluster on cluster, a cluster bootstrapping design that seems pretty well followed. We've done some work with cluster API, which promises but doesn't quite deliver generic abstractions for bare metal. We're doing a lot of work with OpenShift ACM, which provides a similar, more dedicated tooling for OpenShift. It definitely spins those things up. And we've seen other distros, specifically like Talos, where you can do this work if you have the API and lifecycle controls of a bare metal cloud to do that work. Something we see as very, very exciting, and the ROI is tremendous, not just because you can eliminate a virtualization layer, but because you can buy different equipment. You don't have to buy the expensive virtualization hosts. You can move into a different architectural model. Another technology coming and that we see as exciting is the idea of a computer express link, or PCIe, growth and expansion. This lets you look at servers in a different way. You break out of the chassis defining the server, and you start thinking about ways that you can build more interesting infrastructure. We see this happening when people want to build servers that have what I would consider an impossible number of GPUs, memory cards, or SSDs. If you need like a 10, 20 GPUs in your inferencing or your model rendering box, there's times when you really want to scale up your capabilities of a server, but a server itself couldn't be built like that. The chassis just can't hold 20 GPUs or power 20 GPUs. And so those are really good use cases. I've heard some real enthusiasm around shared RAM models where CXL can be used to access a pool of shared RAM that is faster than networking and really good for model training. Along that same lines, that's effectively becoming an ultra-fast NIC or interface, or maybe being able to have one or two smart NICs that can service the outbound networking for a whole cluster. So some really interesting designs that are considered in this. One thing that gets talked about a lot with CXL that I'm not as big a fan of is this idea of it being a composable dynamic infrastructure where you can buy a set of commodities and then dynamically build a server with this much RAM and that many GPUs or this much storage and then give it back to the pool and reconfigure it. I think those are interesting concepts, but generally if you're buying commodities, RAM, GPUs, or disks, you want to put them into use. And the idea of leaving enough free that you can reassign and rededicate it maybe has some lab interest, but for the cost of this technology, I just haven't seen it catching on yet. If you have a use case that you think this is perfect for, let me know. We actually integrate with a lot of CXL technologies and can help create a very dynamic OS deployment behind this. And so we find this to be a fascinating technology from a dynamic infrastructure perspective. The other thing to consider when you're looking at how to improve your infrastructure stance going forward and take advantage of all this change is to think about new provisioning techniques. Rather than just doing a network boot or provision, a lot of companies are looking at their cloud infrastructure processes. They're thinking about how they manage images in cloud or even in container OSs. And so we see that as a very productive technique also on bare metal, actually allowing companies to converge the way they build and manage images. These are all pipeline strategies. So we're showing these as pipelines. In the immutable image base, you're able to take a base OS, configure your app, and then capture an image. Once you have that image captured, you can deploy it in VMs, in the cloud, or on bare metal. We've been supporting processes like this for a long time, and they're very fast, they're very repeatable, and they're incredibly productive. Especially that because when you consider that you can take one image and replicate it reliably and immutably across a fleet of servers. In these cases, you have to be able to have a image provisioning process that starts a base OS, can prepare the server, copy that image to disk, then post-configure it, pre-boot, and then boot the server up. All of those things require specialized tooling. But once you have that tooling in place, it becomes very easy to take images that you've produced for general purpose or VMs and then migrate them into bare metal. That actually accelerates your testing cycles dramatically and makes your whole infrastructure much more consistent. A technique that we're very excited about is something that we've seen Red Hat promoting called Boot C. And that actually lets you go a step further towards allowing developers to define operating system images using the same container technologies, container layers that they're building for containerized deployments in Kubernetes. And in that case, they are defining layers and building those layers into a Docker file. They might even build additional layers into their own repos and store them. And then from once you've defined that Docker file and put the layers that you need into your repos, you can actually boot a system and initialize boot C, and it will pull down the layers and run them as if you're just running a container. So you're literally running your base OS as a container system, and then you can harden, you can manage, you can test and validate. You've really unified your deployment scenarios. And if you were imagining a physical infrastructure with a lot of small machines, this allows you to really have very fine-grained control where instead of having VMs, you might have more powerful or GPU-enabled physical servers doing this work that you would then have tested or built or scaled out in containers, but now transitioned to even more productive bare metal infrastructure. Or you might use this as a way to prep the machines to then run your Kubernetes infrastructure. And then this is a simple way to have immutable Kubernetes deployments. Both are intriguing options. We're still working out some of the how this technology translates into bare metal, but we see it as very promising and productive as a thin boot scenario. I hope this has been a fun journey. We've really taken this idea that as an operator, you're facing a crisis of data center infrastructure management with a lot of change coming at you, a lot of demands, a lot of rug pulling in the sense of VMware. But there are very practical answers. You can turn that crisis into a learning model and then concrete, tangible solutions that don't just fix your infrastructure, but really move it into a whole never dimension, really empower innovation in your own infrastructure. Hope this has been helpful. If you have any questions, please reach out. I'm always happy to talk about these types of concepts and helping you start your own bare metal journey.